From Europe to Africa, from Asia to South America, there's one name that keeps popping up in the railway industry, CRRC. But is China's rail expansion a game changer or a looming disaster? Today, we dive into how China is trying to take over the railway industry and whether that's a good or bad thing for the future of trains. This will be an objective look without propaganda. CRRC didn't just appear out of nowhere. Its roots can be traced back to 1938 with the establishment of the Xinyang Rolling Stock Works, one of China's earliest state-owned enterprises in said industry. In 2015, two of China's rail giants, China CNR Corporation Limited and China South Locomotive Rolling Stock Corporation Limited, joined forces to create CRRC Corporation Limited, probably because they realized their original names were too long. This merger formed one of the largest rolling stock manufacturers headquartered in Beijing. But why is China so invested in railways? Beyond domestic needs, CRRC has been expanding its footprint internationally, aiming to become a dominant player in the global railway industry. Their strategy includes exploring advanced rail technology and establishing partnerships worldwide. But it hasn't been without controversy. CRRC has leveraged its competitive pricing to win contracts worldwide, often undercutting competitors. This aggressive pricing strategy, supported by significant government subsidies, has enabled CRRC to expand its global footprint rapidly. For governments, this is a dream come true. In some places, you have to pick the cheapest option, meaning CRRC almost has a guaranteed win. In Europe, CRRC has made significant inroads by securing contracts to supply composite double-decker trains to 5 countries, including Austria, Germany, and Hungary. Austria-Hungary and Germany together? Hey, I've seen this before. Furthermore, CRRC has partnered with Hungarian group Asemil to establish a rolling stock manufacturing plant in Hungary, aiming to serve the European market more effectively. And it's not just Europe, they have entered America. In Canada, CRRC has delivered 44 multi-level cars to EXO, Montreal's regional commuter rail, with all cars expected to enter by summer 2025, if all goes to plan. In the United States, CRRC secured a contract in 2017 to build 64 subway cars for the Los Angeles Metro, with the potential for additional 200 cars, totaling a $647 million offer, which is not a lot compared to its competitors. The first HR4000 trains began revenue service on the D-Line last year. It's clear CRRC rose to the top really quickly, and its competitors are struggling to fight back. While European giants like Alstom and Siemens attempted to merge in 2019 to create an European rail champion capable of competing globally against the CRRC, the European Commission blocked the merger due to monopoly concerns. Following this, Alstom acquired Bombardier's rail division in 2020, further consolidating the industry. Alstom recently doesn't feel really healthy. Their sales have been delayed for a long time. But don't worry, Stadler, you are still the best. No one will ever hurt you because you're perfect. And hey, if you love trains, transit and deep dives like this, make sure to click that subscribe button. It really helps the channel grow and you won't miss any future videos. The topic of this video came to mind with the announcement of a new rail line in Brazil, this capybara's home country. If you are not aware, Brazil barely has inner-city rail. However, recently a world-class rail line is being built between São Paulo, the country's largest city, and Campinas, a town you probably never heard of. The line will not be high-speed rail, but for Brazil it will be fast. The line will follow this route, starting in Barra Funda, a district you probably never heard of and I don't recommend visiting if you come here, there's nothing interesting there, and stop at Jundiaí, a town perfect for rail enthusiasts, and then go on to Campinas. The TIC, or Train Intercidades, Inner City Train, will feature an express service covering a 101-kilometer route. Trains are expected to reach speeds up to 140 kilometers per hour. The journey from São Paulo to Campinas is projected to take approximately 64 minutes, a considerable improvement over the current travel times. The thing is, guess who is going to build this line named TIC? Yes, CRRC. The project is a collaboration between Brazil's Grupo Comporte and China's CRRC, with the latter holding holding a 40% stake in the consortium. This partnership highlights CRRC's expanding global presence and its role in modernizing rail infrastructure in other countries. Construction is set to begin next year, with the intra-metropolitan service expected to commence in 2029 and express service in 2031, you know, before that meteor comes to Earth. The announcement of CRRC's involvement in TIC is a major milestone for the country's rail industry. But if history has taught us anything, it's that deals like this often come with strings attached. CRRC's entry into Brazil follows the same playbook it has used worldwide: undercut competitors with lower costs and secure major contracts. With a 40% stake in the TIC project, CRRC's involvement is substantial, and that raises questions about its long-term intentions. The Chinese rail giant isn't just looking to sell trains, it's looking to dominate the market. Brazilian industry groups and international critics have long pointed out that CRRC's price strategy is artificially low, backed by Chinese state subsidies. This allows CRRC to beat out competitors like Alstom and Siemens and CAF in Brazil, not necessarily because of their superior technology, but because they can afford to operate at a loss until they establish global dominance. Once that happens, costs could increase and Brazil might find itself locked into an over-reliance on Chinese rail technology. The thing is that CRRC has the backing of the Chinese government and, most importantly, a lot of industry. China has a bunch of industry. But surprisingly and infamously, their consumer market is not that big yet, it's still growing. So China needs to expand globally and sell their industrialized projects. But the political landscape can shift, and in fact it's already doing that. President Donald Duck announced new tariffs to China. This could impact the most important part of CRRC's strategy: leverage and their competitive pricing. Once seen as a cheaper alternative to Siemens and Alstom, now, at least to Americans, CRRC can become more expensive. Let's see how Europe will respond to Donald's tariffs and if in 2 or 3 years they will be striving for free trade, or if Europe will also tariff China and other countries. Oh, that was a lot of politics. But are these trains actually good? Well, that depends on who you ask. For transit agencies, CRRC's biggest selling point is its affordability. Compared to European and Japanese manufacturers, CRRC trains are significantly cheaper, making them an attractive option for budget-conscious rail networks. But lower costs sometimes mean compromises in quality. Some operators have reported issues with delays in production, poor customer support, and difficulties with long-term maintenance. The Los Angeles Metro, that I cited early for example, experienced a lot of problems with its CRRC rail cars. They recently opted for Hyundai Rotem instead of continuing to buy from China. The MBTA order isn't even complete, but for rail fans and passengers, they're fine. The MBTA trains were a bit rough around the edges when they entered service, but for everyday passengers, CRRC trains often look and feel modern and comfortable, specifically compared to aging fleets they are replacing. Rail enthusiasts are often divided. Some appreciate that CRRC is bringing rail travel to more places at a relatively affordable price, while others criticize them for lacking the craftsmanship and reliability of manufacturers like Siemens, Alstom, and my beloved Stadler. However, other users hate this rolling stock equipment, calling them modern jail cells on wheels. So, what's the final verdict? Is CRRC truly taking over the rail industry? Well, in many ways, yes. Their aggressive pricing, government backing, and ability to undercut competitors have made them a dominant force in the global rail market. They've expanded into Europe, North America, Latin America, securing contracts that would have once gone to Alstom, Siemens, and Bombardier. Rest in peace, my friend. And as more countries look for cheaper alternatives to upgrade their rail network, CRRC will likely continue to grow. But that doesn't mean it's all smooth sailing. Political tensions, quality concerns, and security issues could continue to cast a shadow over their expansion. Some governments are already pushing back, banning CRRC from certain projects or increasing scrutiny over their bids. Meanwhile, issues like delays, software glitches, and long-term maintenance problems are starting to raise red flags for transit agencies. Let's hope the future of CRRC is bright and well-maintained. Hey, but if you want to see the future of high-speed rail in Australia, mate, I have just a thing for you. Click this video on the screen right now.